Hi, this is Eric from longboxreview.com. Welcome to the Rose City Comic Con Diaries episode. So in early September 2018, me, my wife, and my two granddaughters, Madison and Gabby, all went to Rose City Comic Con. This is, I don't remember how many times we've gone now, but this is the fourth or fifth time that we've gone to Rose City Comic Con. And it's become sort of a family affair, a family vacation, which is actually the only vacation we took this year. But yeah, we did that. And after every day of the con, I got together with Gabby and Maddie, and we talked about our day, the previous day at the con. And so you'll hear Gabby, then Maddie, and then I think Maddie, and then Gabby. I recorded them individually those first couple days. And then after that, there's about an hour-long recording of me with Damian and Matt, whom I also talked to last year when I went to Rose City Comic Con, if you want to go back and listen to that episode. And so, yeah, there's that. There's about an hour long. We recorded at a place called McMenamin's. So it's a pub and a lot of background noise. So I hope the recording, I hope our discussion is not drowned out by that. It didn't seem to me to be the case when I was reviewing the recording, but it's still kind of loud. And be warned, there is some language as part of that discussion. And then come back and you'll hear me talking with Madison and Gabby once again to talk about the final day of our con experience. And at the end of that, I'll have some final wrap-up thoughts about the con from my own perspective. So come back for that. And so here you go. I hope you enjoy this Rose City Comic Con 2018 Diaries. Take it away, girls.
Okay, I am here with 14-year-old Gabby, right? 14?
Yes.
Yeah. Sometimes I forget your age. It's because I'm old and have lost my brain cells. So we're talking about Rose City Comic Con Day 1, Thursday, September 7th.
Yes.
So Gabby, how was the first day of the con for you?
It's actually pretty fun. I liked all the artwork and everything I basically saw.
Yeah. So what was the coolest thing that you saw from yesterday?
From yesterday, the coolest thing I saw was the horse picture, which is very colorful.
You're talking about the one where the artist had drawn a bunch of these horses, and this particular one had the interior of the horse was like a galaxy, contained a galaxy inside it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was pretty cool. We have to go back and find that artist and see if we can buy that one.
Yeah.
For you. Okay. You attended a lot of panels with me yesterday. What was the most interesting one?
The very first one.
The very first one.
Which I forgot their names, but
Kelly Sue DeConnick and Chelsea Kane Spotlight.
Yeah.
Yeah, and why was that? Why was that your favorite one?
It was my favorite one because it's like they're really funny and their comics sound really interesting to me. really want one of those.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else?
No.
Anything else stand out in your mind about yesterday's con? Because you were kind of I think you were getting a little bored with all of the panels that I went to yesterday.
Yeah, I was.
what was the one where you were just kind of sitting off, not really paying attention? The DC art panel?
Yeah, it's the drawing panel.
See, I thought that was one of the more interesting ones. we'll get a different perspective on that panel from Maddie.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, of course, we walked around a lot. There's always a ton of walking. But it wasn't too crowded. That's what I liked about it.
No.
And we certainly did not see all of the show floor yet. That was the other question I was going to ask you. So the first thing that we did once we got onto the floor is we went to find all of the comic book sellers. Mm-hmm. And I was looking for comic books. Is that not the best thing in the world to do at a con?
It actually is, because it's a comic con, and we're looking for comics and other artwork.
I thought you were going to say no. Quite honestly, I thought you were going to say, no, that's the most boring thing ever.
No, that's the point of coming to the con, because it's called a comic con.
Oh, you're great. Okay, so final question. Did you see what of all of the cosplay that you saw yesterday, what was your favorite things that you saw, or favorite thing?
Well, I saw a lot of stormtroopers.
Mm-hmm. Really? I didn't really see that many stormtroopers.
There was this little kid area that had a lot of stormtroopers dressed up for kids to take pictures with.
Okay. I meant just kind of walking around.
Oh, kind of walking around? No, but there was...
Wait. Before you... And it kind of bothers me that you like the stormtroopers so much. Those are the bad guys of the movie series, right? You know that, right?
Yes, I know that.
Okay, go on.
I didn't really like most of them, but I liked one specific one. There's this guy that dressed up as a zombie, and when I was walking back from going to the bathroom to the panel we were at, mm-hmm. he walked out of his bathroom, and now he made me jump.
Wait. You liked his zombie look because he made you jump, or because it was just a cool looking...
Because it was a really cool looking zombie.
Okay.
But it was really funny. That part would have been, it's really funny. I jumped when he came out of the bathroom and he went, walked right in front of me. It's like, whoa.
All right. Okay. Anything else about con day one?
No.
All right. Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. I am here with 10-year-old Madison.
I am not 10.
We had this conversation in the last episode you were on, didn't we?
Yes, I think we did.
Fine. Nearly 13-year-old Madison.
There you go.
There we go. Okay, so how was your first day of Rose City Comic Con in general?
Good. It was very good and fun.
Why was it fun?
I don't know. It just was. Like, the cool, like, the cosplay was kind of cool.
Only kind of cool?
Yeah.
Yeah. I heard you talking about this earlier, so you didn't really see anything that was all that really great or fantastic yesterday?
Like, there's that one guy who's super, like, who can stretch a lot in the DC comics. I forgot his
Plastic
name.
Plastic Man?
Yeah. I saw a girl dressed up as him.
Yes. That was amazing.
Yeah. And then...
I saw a Nightcrawler. He's from Marvel Comics. Yeah. Blue skin with a tail. Did you see him too?
Maybe.
Yeah. Well, that was pretty amazing, I thought. But.
We saw the baby Yoda.
Baby Yoda. Was that with the, was it the woman that was carrying Yoda on her back?
I thought it was a guy.
Oh, I saw a woman that had a Yoda.
It was a guy it was Star Wars. He was dressed up and then he had his baby on his shoulders. Mm-hmm. And he was Yoda.
Oh, the baby was a Yoda.
Yeah.
Oh, see, the woman I saw was just like a doll type thing. So the baby was dressed up as Yoda? Oh my God, I wish I would have seen that.
We saw it while we were sitting at Kirby Crackle.
Oh, I missed that. Yeah, because when we were sitting there listening to Kyle sing, they kept bringing out all these different, characters.
Like Peppa Pig, George Pig.
Peppa Pig and
George.
The trolls.
Yes.
The trolls from, what was the movie? Was it Trolls the movie?
Yeah.
Okay.
Branch and Poppy E.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So there's that. I wanted to ask you, because one of the greatest things I think there is about going to a Comic-Con is shopping for comics. And I know that's your favorite thing in the world, right?
Totally.
Thank you for your honesty, Madison. Okay. Well, anyway, I found some cool stuff. But so you went to some panels. Not all with me. But what was your favorite panel that you attended?
DC Art Academy.
DC Art. I knew you were going to say that. And so that was the one where a bunch of artists that had done work for DC Comics, with I think one exception. I'm not sure how that guy got on there. I think he was friends with one of the other artists.
But, yeah, and he doesn't matter. Like, came up. He's just like,
He made some really cool art. He drew some really cool pictures. Mm-hmm. But besides the thing that I know you're going to say, what was the best thing about that particular panel?
I got to watch them draw and just, like, work. I got to watch them work and mm-hmm. see how they do it.
Right, right. So, yeah, they had a camera so that you could see them actually drawing as they were drawing, which I love those things. That's really cool.
And them answering my question was funny because they are just like, I don't know.
Let's back up. So, you wanted to ask a question,
mm-hmm.
and I said, go right ahead. And what was the question you asked?
Why do you draw?
Why do you draw? And the response to that was pretty funny.
They had no idea.
Well, they did. But it's like, that's a very existential question for an artist.
What?
drawing is their life. And so how do you answer something that is your life? How do you answer a question like that? It's just like,
it's just what I do.
It's exactly, exactly.
It's an easy answer for me.
As they were drawing stuff, you asked a question, other people asked questions at the very end of the panel. What happened?
Well, I asked my question and then they answered and they said, since it was a very good question, I got one of the art.
Yeah.
And it was Batgirl.
Drawn by Chrissy Zulo.
Yes.
I believe.
I think so.
That was amazing. That drawing. I can't wait to show this in the future video that we always do.
Yes.
I'll have you show it. So, okay. So other than that, there was one other thing that happened yesterday that you got really excited about. What was that?
I got, some books from Sebastian Jones.
What was the book? The main
Niobe.
Niobe, yeah.
And I got his children books.
Yep. And the I Am series. So there was I Am of Mixed Race, and I am
Living in Two Homes.
Two Homes.
I Am Awesome.
Oh, is that the other one? I Am Awesome. I didn't look at that one. I'll have to take a look at that one. And then there was one other one, right?
Yeah, I don't remember the other one.
Yeah. Okay, well, we'll show it in the video.
I also got Pinata.
Pinata?
Pinata. It's the one.
Oh, right. The one that, okay, tells the story of how to make a pinata.
Yeah, and the pig pinata.
Yeah.
And the guy that makes pinatas come to life.
Oh, yeah. That kind of like that Pinocchio story.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that.
I also got a poster.
Yeah,
Niobe.
Right. Niobe. Well, that's what drew you in, was seeing that print of the character, and then as I understand it from you and my wife, he was quite the salesman.
Yes, he was.
What did you say? He tells a good story.
He's
or something?
He's a good storyteller.
Good storyteller. Yes, I think he's more of a good salesman. But okay,
he's a good storyteller though.
Okay. All right. Okay. Anything else about the con you want to say
from
yesterday?
We found out that Sebastian Jones is also working with Rue from The Hunger Games.
And her name is?
Her real name is?
Looking it up here. That's the artist, Ashley Woods. Amandla Stenberg?
Yes.
That's Rue?
Yes.
Okay.
It is Rue from The Hunger Games, so.
Yeah, so, and yeah.
And she is also a model of Niobe.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I can see that in the, I think in the eyes of the character on the cover here.
I can see it in just like the face.
Yeah. All right. Anything else?
No, I don't think so.
All right, so you're looking forward to day two?
Yes.
And day three?
Yes.
Hopefully and going back
there
home?
Is more, no. Hopefully there is more cosplay.
Today's Saturday, so I bet you there's going to be a lot more people and a lot more cosplay, and just keep your eyes open. We'll talk about it in the future. So this is Sunday morning of the con. We're going to talk about yesterday, Saturday, which was the second day of the con.
Mm-hmm.
So Madison, what were the highlights of yesterday for you?
Well, I'm not sure. I liked watching Kirby Crackle,
mm-hmm.
and
The 10 minutes you got to
yep and
watch him.
Sebastian Jones.
Right, because the reason you could not finish listening and watching Kirby was that you went to the Sebastian Jones panel, which was all about what exactly?
How to create a story.
Yeah, the creative process. And
yeah.
He was giving some advice, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm.
Based on his experience. And what's funny, because you and I talked about him in the first set, or the first recording that we did, and you told me your experience with him. And then Saturday, you and I, when we first got to the con, you went with me, and Gabby went with
Grandma.
And so we were shopping for comics, which is, I thought you were going to say that was the best thing about your day yesterday, but no. Madison doesn't want to answer that question. We walked by his table, and he remembered you.
Yep.
Remembered your name and shook my hand.
Yes.
I thought it was, you know, for all the stories that you and Kitra were telling me, I couldn't believe how charming he actually was. So
he's very nice.
Yeah, he was. He was very nice. Okay, so before we started recording, you mentioned something about the cosplay.
Yes.
What about that?
I liked a lot of the cosplay. I haven't gotten any pictures, but my favorite one was the Blue Devil.
Blue Devil. You mean the guy with the tail? That's Nightcrawler.
That's what I meant.
Blue Devil is actually a character from DC Comics.
Oh.
But yeah, that was pretty good.
Yeah.
I saw him yesterday, I saw him on Friday as well.
Also, the Beast Boy was cool, too.
The Beast Boy was cool. Well, did you see all the Titans? The Teen Titans?
I saw a few of them.
They had a Raven, a Robin, Beast Boy. I don't remember seeing a Starfire, but there was a Cyborg as well. And they were doing a group shot.
I didn't see that.
Hmm.
I did see some Wizard of Oz and yes. Incredibles.
Yeah. Wasn't there a mother-daughter Incredible
yes.
duo?
Yeah.
Incredibles duo. Yeah, that they look good. And the Wizard of Oz.
There was a family
Tin Man,
one, too.
A Scarecrow. Did you see a lion?
Yes.
You did?
I think so. I might not have. I did.
I didn't see one.
I'm not sure. But we saw Baby Yoda.
You did? Again?
That was yesterday. No.
Oh, yeah, right. We talked about that already.
Yeah.
Or did we? I don't remember.
No.
I don't remember we talked about it on the mic or not.
I don't think so.
Yeah, maybe just a conversation we were having. Anyway. So what else about yesterday was lots of fun? We saw Felicia Day.
Oh, yeah, that was fun. I forgot about that.
That was a lot of fun. We missed out on apparently the best panel ever, which was David Tennant's panel, which is the one that Kitra and Gabby went to while we went shopping.
Yeah.
So I apparently missed out. We apparently missed out. Oh, well.
Oh, well.
Maybe it'll be on YouTube. That happens. People record stuff and put it on YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. What else? What else did we do?
Mm-hmm.
What else did you do besides mope around because we were shopping for comics? Or is that about it?
No. I'm trying to think.
Yeah, thinking silently is good for dead air.
What?
For the recording.
Oh. Well, I don't know. I saw a lot of princesses, too. Oh, wait. And, like, with The Wizard of Oz, I saw the No, wait. I'm not sure if it was for Wizard of Oz or for Wicked. I saw the Good Witch and the Bad Witch.
What? Well, they're
the Good Witch of the North and the Bad Witch of the West.
They're both characters in both sets of stories. So.
I know. I don't know what they were trying to do, though.
Which version they were doing?
Yes. Because one was pink. I saw a white one, I think, and a pink one. I saw two.
Right. We did stop by Chrissy Zulo's table.
I got a sticker.
So that you could thank her for the Batgirl sketch that you won at the DC Art Academy panel on Friday.
Mm-hmm.
She was really nice.
Yes.
And she also remembered you as well. And I thought some of the stuff that she talked to you about was about art and all that kind of stuff was very encouraging of her for you. I don't know how you feel about it.
I don't know.
Okay.
I just know a lot of this stuff from we came to con, and I think it was like the first night of con, or this like a while ago. You're just like, this stuff makes me want to start writing again.
Drawing. Yeah.
That's what I mean.
Well, writing and drawing. That's true. Yeah. We'll see. And then
I'll draw for you.
And there was okay. Let's make a comic together.
Except if it has animals, then I'm like, okay, bye. I can't draw animals.
That's
right. I can't draw their body.
A lot of people that work professionally in comic books can't draw animals either.
Like, I can't draw bodies, like animal bodies, but I can draw their face and their tail.
Oh, I know something else that you particularly enjoyed, and that was when we went over to Damien's house for dinner and you got to hang out with his daughter.
Yeah.
You guys seemed to really hit it off. So, you enjoyed that, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
And hopefully I get to see her today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he said he might be able to bring her for a little bit today. So.
Mm-hmm.
All right, anything else?
Not that I know of.
All right, well, we got to get busy because the con's already open as we record this, and we are not ready to go. So.
And I am hungry.
And go eat so we can go. So, Gabby, how was your con, second day of con?
It was pretty fun.
Really?
Yeah.
So, why was it fun? What'd you do?
I basically just walked around and got a couple things.
Yesterday, Madison and I talked about the things that she got from Sebastian Jones. I tell you what, guys, that guy is getting a lot of mentions in this episode. Thumbs up for Maddie. But you hadn't gotten anything yet. So what was the special thing that you got yesterday?
The horse picture with the galaxy.
Did we talk about
the nebula?
Did we talk about that on Mike last time? The horse picture that has the nebula space interior thing.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, we'll show that on a future video that we'll do. But there was something else, a book, right?
Yeah, I forgot what it was called. But
you forgot the book that you got?
No, I mean the title of the book, but it's about ancient Egypt, and an adventure book.
Oh yeah. I don't remember the title either, but
it's like Rocket something.
Rocket what? Madison's telling us. Rocket what?
I just rocket something.
Rocket something?
I can get my book.
No, that's all right. Okay. Yeah, that I remember walking by that table that was selling that book on the first day and thought, well, that looks interesting. So I get to read that, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
You can read it.
Good. Thank you. What else did you enjoy about yesterday?
I also enjoyed seeing all the really cool costumes that everybody wore, like the Wonder Woman and like four or five Doctor Strangers I saw.
I saw a lot of Doctor Strange cosplay.
Yeah, and that priest, like the scary priest that was like at the Kirby Crackle concert thing yesterday.
Scary priest? I don't
remember the guy.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, yes, yeah. You did point that out, him out to me. I don't know what that was exactly. But I forgot to talk to Madison about this earlier. But she had pointed out a Groot.
Oh, I saw that.
That was
too.
Like this big, giant head of Groot. It was, I think they were going for like, you know, the adult life size version of Groot. That was pretty cool. What we saw of it, because we actually didn't see all of the body. It was just the head popping up above on a different level of the convention center. But
I saw the whole body.
You did?
Yeah, he was out the window when me and Grandma were walking to David Tennant or somebody.
Oh, okay. How was the David Tennant panel?
I barely could understand him, but it was funny. Kind of funny. Some of it I could.
And why could you barely understand him? Was it because your fingers were in your ears?
No, because I can't understand the Scottish accent.
I hear from a lot of Scots that they have the same problem.
Yeah.
I don't know. I maybe heard one person say that. They're probably joking. Okay. Anything else?
No.
All right. Well, I guess it's on to the final day of the Comic-Con. And hopefully we have some good experiences today, too.
Hopefully.
Okay. Let's go.
All right, so we're drinking. Who's we? Oh, wait, what's going on? Do we need the intro?
No. No, we don't.
So
we are here at McMiniman's on...
On Broadway.
On Broadway, because that's how you introduced the last time we were together.
Oh, did I?
Yes.
We're on McMiniman's on Broadway in Portland, Oregon.
In beautiful Portland, Oregon, because we are here for the Rose City Comic Con 2018. I'm here with Matt.
Hello.
Of the... is it former, or is it? Are you still doing the videos on Wednesday's Serial Channel?
They exist. I should do more.
Yeah,
but in theory, I'm still there.
But more importantly, maybe I don't know. In addition to, he's also the co-host of the Untold Talks of Spider-Man, and more importantly,
yes,
the co-host,
extremely important,
with Damian. Of the Never Stay Dead podcast, one of my new favorite podcasts ever.
Yes, and the number one project in Matt's life.
Yes.
It's true, whenever Damian deigns that we're worthy of doing another podcast.
Whenever.
Then you cancel your plans with Kane and call me and come straight to me.
Right? Oh, yeah. No, you're much prettier than Kane is.
I'm sorry, Kane, if that's true, you're in trouble.
Oh, my gosh. All right, we're good. I'm checking the battery levels.
So we've been doing a lot of arguing this evening, so we thought we'd continue with that.
Discussion.
So on a more honest level, or a less hyperbolic level, how would you place Tom King's Batman, these 54 issues so far? In
what level?
In your estimate of top comics, where does the Tom King run so far?
I think so far it's one of the better runs on a series that I've read in 10 years?
Uh-huh.
15 years, maybe?
How would you...
15, okay.
You wouldn't rank it above Batman Year One, would you? Maybe? Oh, my.
No.
It's because it's hard to compare 54 issues to 4 issues.
That is such an iconic story.
Right.
That it's really... I mean, David Mazzucchelli and Frank Miller just did...
That's a mini, not a series, right?
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
But if you're going to rank things, you just have to pick the best thing.
I think it's unfair to equate those two things, because Batman Year One is one of those origin stories that transcends the character,
right,
to some degree.
That's one of the comics...
But there was a time when it was just the latest issues of Batman coming out.
That's
and now
true.
Tom King is just the latest issues
that,
of Batman.
Very true. Out. Very true.
Is that any comic ever made?
Yeah, but, I mean, it wasn't an event when it came out. It was just the regular issues of Batman.
That's not true.
It is true. I was there.
No. Who cares? So
it was Batman, whatever numbers. I can't remember.
Yeah, exactly, right? Because I have the trade of this as well as the issues, right? Because I got it when it came out. It was just number blah, 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 through blah, 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 right? And it wasn't a thing other than trade dress on the issues.
Right. It was only after the fact that everyone realized, exactly. Wow, look what's happened.
Exactly.
Look what they did.
I don't know. Maybe not after
Maybe real insidery people, but me as a regular reader at the time.
Because it was after Dark
And there
Night.
Wasn't the kind of hype you get now.
Exactly.
I just remember going and, wow, look at that. It's Frank Miller. And I hadn't heard of David Mazzucchelli before, so I didn't know how great of an artist he was going to be going in.
Boy, once you read that, you knew how great
he
was.
Right.
Yeah, so, okay, yeah, now that we're talking about it, no, the Tom King Batman does not transcend that one, but it's pretty damn good, in my opinion.
So it transcends most longer runs you've read in comics.
I think
in recent times.
I think so. I love Tom King's style.
Uh-huh.
I love his take on this character. The Bruce, it's not his Batman. It's his Bruce Wayne. His Bruce Wayne under the cowl.
Uh-huh.
That is what I'm really gravitating towards on this.
So, I mean, for me, I feel like there's been some fabulous issues, but the overall thing, I don't connect with it, or I don't quite see what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for whatever King's doing, I'm not there. And when I read his Vision, and I'm reading Mr. Miracle, I can get it. Although Mr. Miracle's more complicated and going. But with his Batman, to me, it's his lesser work. Maybe just because I'm not connecting to it.
Lesser
than
to those.
The Vision and the Mr. Miracle.
Well, I don't know. It's kind of hard to.
It may be hard to compare.
Compare those because those are limited runs on very specific takes on those characters.
Those are ones where he's taking more minor characters and kind of doing a whole new thing with
them. Yes, exactly.
Giving them the Tom King treatment.
The Tom King treatment.
And Batman, he's sometimes giving it. To me, it seems like he's saying, okay, I'm going to give him the Tom King treatment.
Wait.
No, I'm pulling back and I'm doing something else.
Do you think he's doing the Tom King thing like he did on Vision and Miracle Man and applying it to Batman? And that's...
It doesn't
mesh?
I think he's hesitating to apply it. That was my take. Going halfway.
Is he hesitating or is it editorial who's like...
Well, that could be it.
Tom,
I mean, I'm just the reader.
Love your stuff, Tom, but Batman is a different animal.
But I question if Tom King is really a superhero guy. Because I feel
he's not.
Doing the Vision, he did the Vision as not a superhero, and he's doing Mr. Miracle as not a superhero. With Batman, I feel like he's torn between trying to do a superhero and doing this non-superhero thing he does
characters. That's exactly right. I think that's perhaps, let's ask Matt.
Yes.
Is that the issue? Is that he's trying to do a non-superhero thing with the most one of the most iconic superheroes of all time?
I don't give a crap about Batman as a superhero, so that's not it for me.
Okay.
I just don't like his run. I don't like anything about it.
That's too easy. Don't you like
We've
about
done 2 hours about this already. And I feel bad enough. I hate digging on
comics. I don't think
you
guys did it long enough.
Well, let's back up a little on Matt, because Matt and I were talking about this in the car, actually. He doesn't like Tom King's other work, either.
What? No, I said I hadn't read it.
I thought you said you had read Vision.
I haven't touched the Vision. I haven't
read
touched...
some issues of
Mr. Miracle.
And you didn't get into those?
Well, so I read, like, 2 issues of Mr. Miracle, and after half of it being just saying Darkseid is, I don't feel like I got a good read on it, but it didn't grab me yet.
It's two words. How can you not get a read?
Okay,
yeah, it's two words, and there's nothing else in it.
Those two words are packed with so much meaning. Come on.
There's no meaning. You said 10 years, and so I took a look at what was Batman 2008. So Grant Morrison.
That's what you're doing on your phone.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm paying attention. Grant Morrison had some stuff coming out. R.I.P., The Black Hand, stuff like that.
Right.
Now that's Batman.
That is good Batman. I've read those.
So
that's good stuff.
Tom King's Batman is the whiniest, most self-absorbed, least heroic, and most just insufferable Batman I've ever come across. And I am not the most versed in Batman.
And you've pointed out a lot of how Tom King is very inconsistent and paying attention to the details of continuity and even his own continuity.
And I'm not saying he's written the worst Batman ever. I'm just saying he's the only Batman creator that's needed a bodyguard at SDC to get around because of his Batman run. You know, I'm not the only one.
Wait. What the hell does that even mean?
I don't know. I just know that's the fact.
That's a bunch of dumbasses out there who got so upset that Catwoman and Batman didn't get married that they threatened his life. Come on. That says more about the readership than it does about the authorship.
That's fair.
Did you think that issue 50 of Batman was a well-done issue?
Oh, God, no.
Okay.
That was not... No.
And see, that, for me, because it was...
That was
both
editorial.
Because it was hyped and because it was... The
build up of
the focal point of a long build up really turned me against this Batman run. I stopped reading it and I plan to come back to it when it's completed and read it all at once rather than month by month be kind of annoyed by it.
Because we're in the top.
And
King
I'm hoping
run.
To love it when it's all done, but I don't know if I will. But I hated issue 50 and it made me retroactively dislike about 20 issues leading up to it.
Oh, so I don't understand that.
He's been on jury duty and had to give up being Batman for a hot minute, right?
Okay.
Is that where we're at?
Yeah, the cold days? Is that the storyline?
But Matt and I can certainly judge that storyline having not read it. Or have you read it?
I've read, I think, all but the most recent issue.
Oh, okay. I just read that most recent issue.
I don't know why I keep reading it.
And on Twitter you said you thought the last issue was brilliant. Number 54.
Yeah, I thought it was great. Yeah.
I favorited that tweet.
Thank you.
Yeah.
We give hearts to all of Eric's tweets in hopes that he'll invite us back on the podcast.
That will happen.
I try to be friendly with opinions I don't necessarily agree with all the time, you know. Xavier Files, if you're listening.
It's too bad Tom King wasn't at this con so we could abuse him in person.
What? He was at Denver.
Oh, and did you approach his table?
I talked to him real quick.
What did you say?
Nothing much. I said...
Love your work?
I said something fairly innocuous and tried to get a signature
on
it.
Like, get off Batman right now?
Yeah, that's what... No, of course not.
You tried
not.
To get his signature on what?
I got a signature on a Batman issue.
Uh-huh. You hypocrite.
You got a signature on one of the worst comics.
How am I a hypocrite for being generally polite? Jesus. No,
it's
kind
of abused Matt Knight. It's turning into
it is. We have been teaming up on him a little bit, haven't we?
Tom King is interesting because his personality in person is much different than the vibe I get online or from his books. Because his books tend to have a more schizophrenic, like, personality divide that I get from a lot of them. Especially, like, The Vision or Miracle Man.
Miracle Man especially.
But Mr. Miracle.
Did I say Miracle Man? Holy
you
crap.
Both said Miracle Man.
That's right.
Say
what I said.
Alan Moore character.
Who cares about DC? It doesn't have Spider-Man.
Well, Tom King in writing is very, like, I'm Mr. Slick, modernistic guy. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if that goes with his personality. What I've seen in interviews, he's, gee shucks, I'm just humbled to be here kind of guy.
Yeah.
But doesn't come across as this intellectual architect of, you know, finely chiseled stories the way I read them.
Have you guys read his novel, A Once Crowded Sky?
I got out of the library once and started it, and I couldn't renew it or something, so I didn't finish it. I kept meaning to get it again.
You know how I feel about
books.
Have
you read it?
I have read it, yes.
And what did you think of it?
I quite enjoyed it, but if you read that book, you have a good sense of where he's coming from a writing standpoint, from a narrative storytelling standpoint. It's the blueprint for what he's doing right now.
Huh. I mean, the bits I read, it was all out of order.
Mm-hmm.
And it was about a sidekick and a superhero. I need to get it back. I was actually hoping there was an audiobook.
I think it's worth... Would you want him to read it? Or would you want somebody else to read
Probably
it?
Probably an actor to read it.
Yeah.
I'm just more doing audiobooks than prose novels lately.
Yeah.
Do you think we can get a ghost critic to read it?
If you pay him enough.
Okay.
He needs the cash. What made you think of ghost critic?
Well, he has a pretty voice.
Ah, yes. Yeah. And he trained as an actor.
Oh,
did
really?
He?
I believe so. In college, I think he was a theater major.
No.
I guess that doesn't mean he trained as an actor. He could have been doing something else in theater.
Okay.
But that's what I seem to remember him mentioning once. But. So how long does the battery have? Should we move on to other subjects?
I don't know.
Oh, you don't know.
Well, I think we should move on to another subject so I don't look like the demon all night.
Do you want to talk about Rose City Comic Con? Since ostensibly why we're here.
Yeah, Tom King's not even here. That's so right. Really.
What the hell? Why did he...
We saw Jim Starlin.
Yeah.
Okay, I want to ask you about that. Because yes. I was late to the panel because my granddaughter Madison just had to watch all these DC artists talk about their art and their process and all that stuff, which was very fascinating.
Sounds like it should be good.
It was great. It was a great panel. But I was really wanting to go to the Jim Starlin panel because he's long been one of my favorite creators. I love his Warlock stuff. I love his Captain Marvel stuff. You know, he's big right now. And when I was there at the panel, he was talking about the impact of Thanos on him.
Right.
And so, you know, I missed about half an hour or so. So what did I miss, guys?
There was a lot on his beginnings, like even like his life when he was in the army and how other people would set up their stereos and he set up a drawing board in the barracks. And, I mean, there must have been some missing elements because he was like, oh, yeah, the first job I got was as art director at Marvel where I designed the covers and I would go meet with Stan Lee and he would say, this is a great idea here, but couldn't we do it this way? And then Stan Lee would jump up on the desk and do poses. And he explained how Stan Lee had wanted to be an actor, but his family made him go into comic book editing. And he also mentioned that Stan Lee had 3 wigs in his office on display,
okay,
which blew my mind.
Oh, that's not the biggest detail.
Okay.
What's the biggest detail?
The biggest detail was Stan Lee would set his glasses behind him on a chair. And when he was acting out these scenes that he was talking about, he would inevitably climb down. And every third time or so, he would sit down on his glasses and break them. And then he'd call in his secretary and said, I've done it again. She'd come up, clean up the remnants of the glasses, set a new pair on the desk, and then go try to get
them
repaired.
Go to the optometrist to get the broken ones repaired.
Come on.
What he said.
I have to wonder is how much of this is apocryphal,
you know,
or how much of it is something that didn't happen quite as often.
Right.
What I'll say: Jim Starlin, unlike a lot of the other old Marvel hands talking about the old days in the office, attributed more to other people, gave more credit to other people,
even
disparagingly talked about himself in a few moments in a way that made him infinitely more believable than a lot of the rest of them.
Yeah.
Not to say he didn't have a charismatic personality that you could tell some of it was picked up from Stan Lee's energy that he learned to showboat with.
Well, and he's a storyteller. He's definitely spinning out the stories in an interesting way.
Right, but it was more believable than your standard Marvel office fare.
Yeah.
So, the fact that Stan Lee broke his glasses a lot, I believe. Whether or not it was every third time, you know, whatever. But
it was a very endearing portrait of Stan Lee, I thought.
It was but not mythic.
Yeah, I was going to say, yeah. It wasn't as glowing, I guess, of Stan Lee. The myth of Stan Lee.
Right.
It was kind of like Stan Lee as this kind of eccentric boss who's kind of goofy, I guess.
Yeah,
anyway.
Yeah.
But also very involved creatively.
Yeah, of course, yeah. You know, the one thing that stood out to me for the time that I was there was how Jim Starlin attributed the Thanos and Death relationship to Sam and Diane from Cheers.
That was quite
amazing. Wasn't that amazing? That was like, oh my god.
Have you even heard of Cheers?
Yay.
You
earlier we ran into the fact that he didn't really know who Ricky and Lucy were from the I Love Lucy show.
Who, Matt?
Matt did.
Yes.
That. Sorry, not Jim Starlin.
Yeah, hang around Matt. I don't know about you, Damian. Hang around Matt makes me feel a little bit older than I feel.
Yes, it does make one feel older.
That's all right, though. That's all right.
Try my best.
There was something else that he said that was like this revelation, like the Sam and Diane thing. Do you remember what that was? I'm blanking on it now. Was there something
else? Well, he said that Thanos, I don't know if this is what you're thinking of, but he said that Thanos was not based on Darkseid, he was based on Metron, one of the other new gods.
Oh, I did not hear that.
That was, yeah.
And Metron is kind of amoral, and he's only interested in knowledge, and not doesn't care whether it hurts anyone or whether it's good or evil.
And you were glancing over the showmanship, because the way he said it was, everybody says I based Darkseid, or based Thanos off of Darkseid, which isn't true. I ripped him off of Metron. It's just this very endearing moment.
I really enjoyed his, I don't know, his honesty, or at least the appearance of the honesty in this conversation. He was just very forthcoming, and you just couldn't help but, I don't know, for me anyway, couldn't help but just believe him for what he was saying.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Another sad, it was sad to hear that he'd hurt his hand and cannot draw anymore.
Oh my god, that was a revelation to me.
That really made me sad.
Because
I love his artwork.
Yes, because, you know, they had done that final OGN, his Thanos OGN for Marvel, and, you know, because he split from Marvel because of that whole fiasco. Right. Was he drawing that one? Was the hand injury or the hand situation, was that a
He said it was a year and a half ago, so I don't know.
Oh, okay.
And he all along has drawn less and less, I think, over the
That's
years.
That's true. That's true.
And he has certain artists that are his go-to artists, like Ron Lim.
Of course.
And now it's Alan Davis.
Alan Davis has been doing the last few OGN. That's right. Well, and to me, that's like, okay, no problem, because
another
Jim Starlin
really
writing
cool
and Alan Davis drawing, that duh, that's a must-buy for me. What else has been the highlights for you guys for Rose City?
I had a revelation with Bendis at this con. I've been waiting 3 years to ask him about his graphic novel, Goldfish. So, for those who aren't familiar, Goldfish is a true crime story about a murderer who took place in Portland in the Hoovervilles that happened when Elliot Ness was taking charge of a murder case. And the Goldfish graphic novel ends with them pinning it on a particular killer. But I did some research after reading it, because it's actually real, and the competing theories goes between three different people as to who is the killer who would leave these people with only their torso, because at the technology at the time, if you only left that much, they had no clues to trace you with. And so Bendis was telling someone at the paper when he was working on it at the time that he was working this book, and his editor just kind of crinkled the finger at him, like, come with me, and went into the back archives. And he had access to all these materials that the paper had amassed but couldn't publish because it didn't meet journalistic standards. But when he looked at all of it, he said, oh, this is who the killer is. And so I found out Bendis had access to this insider knowledge that about no one has had access to for years since the case was opened. That's how he closed his novel. And he said, they basically handed the ending to me, and I had no idea that I was going to stumble across that. And here all these years, I thought he was just piecing together the most probable conclusion to him across the three based on a handful of things he knew. But in fact, he had all this knowledge that even with all my research and reading into it, I would have never run across or heard about. And so is this really fascinating idea that, oh, well, he just knew more because he had access to more reading. And that was the biggest thing for the con for me this year.
I don't know. Can you That's top really that, cool. Damian?
No, I can't.
Because I can't. That's pretty cool.
I've only really gone one day so far, and tomorrow's the last day, so maybe I'll have a highlight tomorrow. I really enjoyed the Jim Starlin
panel.
It's good. I really hated the panel with Kelly Sue DeConnick.
What?
I found it tedious.
What?
I particularly at the beginning when they launched into, I'm not sure if the person who asked the question, the panel moderator, meant them to be talking about Trump or if she meant them to be talking about politics and comics, but
I think she
the
did.
Long talk about Trump.
Yeah.
To me, it felt like she had nothing new to add that I haven't heard a million times and haven't thought myself.
I want to editorialize.
But she took a really long time to say it.
That is true.
So that sort of set the tone for me.
Someone asked a question in this comic panel with Kelly Sue DeConnick and Chelsea Kane, and it led Kelly to a 20-minute, it felt, diatribe about the politics of the day, which I think many could commiserate with, depending where you land on your politics, but even for someone who could agree with her on some level, it was too long of a diatribe for where we were sitting at that moment.
See, okay, so I had to leave the room to take a phone call.
Okay.
With my daughter. Yeah. So I just got the very beginning of that, and then I got the very end of that.
Okay.
But what the sense I got was this very visceral, honest, I'm still formulating my thought type situation from Kelly Sue.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And so it seemed very honest and immediate to her. And so I guess I responded to that. But again, I was gone for about, I don't know, it seemed like 10 minutes, but it probably wasn't quite that long.
Yeah.
So what...
Yeah, I'm trying to remember other stuff that Kelly Sue talked about that also left me very... just... I don't know.
So, I think...
I was more there for Chelsea Kane, really. I wanted... because I'd never seen her on a panel.
Right,
and I wanted to hear more what she had to say. And I did like some of little bits that she said. But both of them seemed to be doing a shtick of some kind.
They seem very comfortable with each other, that's for sure.
Right, right.
Like yeah. They've done this before, perhaps?
Well, and an interesting thing is because Chelsea Kane basically said, and I don't know whether it was genuine, but she said she basically ended up writing comics because she's gone to lots of parties with comic book writers. And at a certain point in my life, I went to lots of parties where I would see Chelsea Kane. And so I kind of pictured Chelsea Kane just going to every party in Portland.
Wait, what?
Yeah.
Really?
Because, yeah, in the early, late 90s, very late 90s, early 2000s, we were sort of, at least occasionally, in the same circles. And, like, I was dating a woman who had gone to the University of Iowa when Chelsea had. And they had parties where they got together, and there Chelsea would be. And then I went to a party from one of my wife's coworkers, and there Chelsea would be. And I also was writing for some websites that she was writing for. So I'd go to editorial meetings, and there were Chelsea. And she's a charming, charming person, a really... mm-hmm. friendly to everybody, gracious kind of person. And I was just sort of wanted to hear more about her in comics.
Yeah, that's true. The panel was...
and there was little bits of it, though.
Yeah, though. Yeah. But the panel was supposed to be a spotlight on those two
right.
ladies.
And their image work.
Ostensibly.
Can I get a pint of Ruby?
Yeah, of course.
I'd like a glass of Ruby.
Glass of Ruby?
Blackberry cider, please.
Sounds great.
What's a glass?
It's a half pint. It's what McMiniman's
Man called. Up. I'm just joking. No.
Dude, I said this before. He's our driver. He's got...
one of the cheapest things here. You can say to a man is man up to try to insult them.
It's true.
It's easy and lazy.
And it's affordable.
And I am the driver.
So he gets major props. Come on, Matt.
It's true. Damian right. is the most beautiful driver I've had tonight.
And I'm happy to woman up.
Woman.
I'm no sexist.
You know.
No matter what Chelsea Kane may think.
Some people would say woman up is the more robust term.
Uh-huh. Oh, I agree. You know, the vagina is the more powerful of the two genitalia. Yeah. But I prefer my penis.
Okay.
Anyway.
Crystal won't be saying man up while she's giving birth.
Yeah, I don't know. I do want to point out, I stopped
oh
by...
Oh, my God.
Chelsea Kane's...
The show is off the rails now.
...booth earlier today.
Yes, and that...
In the vein of genitalia...
Me when you said that, I'm sad.
So, she's selling her... What's the name of the book?
Manhunter. Man-Eaters.
Man-Eaters. Yeah, Man-Eater. Coming out in September, and she was selling some advanced copies at the...
So I went to go pick up a copy, and her booth is pink. It doesn't have her name on it. And
Wait, what? It doesn't have her name?
It doesn't have her name on it.
That's weird.
It is weird. And there's all this... There's some siphonic imagery, and there's a box that said, tips... To defeat the patriarchy.
By siphonic imagery, do you mean vaginas?
Yes. Okay. Well, alluding to, at uh-huh. least. And so, I just stepped away.
This is going to be the weirdest episode of the Long Box Review podcast ever.
Travis isn't even on it.
Well, Chelsea has famously been attacked as a feminist on Twitter.
That's true.
And... I know people on YouTube who've screamed, fuck you, Chelsea Kane, because they're so upset by her feminism. Which, when I read her Mockingbird, I thought was a very mild element.
Yeah, it's really that cover
and
that
so,
just drove people nuts.
Right, and that cover was put up because people were harassing her, as far as you know. And was made up by an artist, not by her. Thanks.
Thank you kindly.
Cider. Thank you.
Nice. Awesome.
What'd you order?
So I'm guessing...
Ruby. Do you want a sip?
No. I had it before. Yeah. I'm just curious.
I'm guessing that all of that experience has influenced her in pushing feminine... Rather than backing down, to push back harder.
Yeah.
Cheers.
But it does... That booth doesn't sound very welcoming to your average male.
Or your extraordinary male, even.
I'm going to try and look for the booth tomorrow and see how
Me
I
too,
feel.
Me too, because I've been actually looking for her...
She's right behind... She's like kitty corner behind Bendis.
Okay. And I saw him today, finally. I need to go... Because I have walked Artist Alley 3 times now.
Yeah?
For various reasons, but...
exercise.
Well, that too.
Gotta get your steps in.
I tell you what, man. Just between you and us...
Uh-huh. And the microphone.
No one else.
And... The age I am. I don't... 3 days is too long for a con. I am done. But I have another day.
Uh-oh.
And I think...
Sit by the pool.
I think... No. That... What? No, that's a waste. Part of the problem is I would go to, like, Emerald City. This is where I'm gonna make a judgment call here. Uh-oh. I love Rose City Comic Con. Not the least for which for coming and seeing Damian and sometimes Matt every other year now.
Yeah.
Matt.
That's why he's not coming back.
Well,
I'll tell you when Matt's coming and you can avoid
yeah,
those years.
Travis. Well, Travis might be coming next year, so that
well,
that'll
then
be a draw.
Matt definitely wants to avoid that.
No.
He's so grungy.
All right, stop it. Travis is awesome. You
he's
know
awesome.
It. You know it. Okay.
I don't know how he smells though.
Okay.
Have you been sniffing us?
What was I saying?
You're gonna make a judgment.
You were
call
talking about
Emerald City.
Yeah. Okay, so one of the major things I come to cons for is the shopping, comic book back issues, right?
Yeah.
I'm sorry. You have, Damian. You have great comic shops in this area, and I've gotten some good stuff. but the selection has not been what I would like it to be. In comparison to, and I'm only comparing this to Emerald City.
Okay.
No. So I have 2 points of contention.
This year seems much better than last.
Really?
Yeah.
No.
In my memory of last year.
I would generally agree with that. Okay, go ahead.
So I've been looking for one issue of comic, and it has not been here, so I'm upset about that. But I can't blame the con for that, because it's very obscure. And the bigger one is that I've been just trying to get some cheap comics, and there's no quarter bins. There's dollar bins.
And they're crappy dollar bins.
Yeah.
Like someone took the comics and put a box on top of them without any kind of protection.
Yeah.
And they're like...
No bags, no boards.
They're like 20 years old.
Yeah. And they're just sitting there. And don't get me wrong, that's fine for a quarter bin.
Yeah.
Not a dollar bin.
Yeah.
And so I picked up a few issues of Spider-Man, and then I was sitting with 10 issues of The Web of Spider-Man in my hand, because that is my lot in life. And then I put them back, because I said, no, this is quarter bin, not dollar bin, and they don't deserve...
Wait.
Four times, or three times.
Okay, so... How many issues do you have in your hand?
10.
Okay. I'm thinking like a, 20, 30 issue run here in your hands here. So you
actually... 10 random issues.
You actually pulled them out.
Yeah.
Had them in your hand. You're contemplating buying them.
I was walking, and then I groaned to myself and put them back, because I thought, this isn't worth $10. This is worth $2. And I put them back, because I looked at the condition. I saw where they were, and I know that next to no one else in this... floor of comic fans cares about any of these comics except for me, because I have a podcast talking about Spider-Man. And so
is that not worth it to you right there?
No, because I can go read those issues for what I normally digest and just go read them, because they're just old Web of
pirate.
So,
he means.
Hmm?
You mean pirate them rather than pay.
Yar. Well, no, I mean, they're everywhere digitally. They're old Web of, so the old 80 Spider-Man comics. They're easy to come by in a million ways. They're cheaper online.
Mm.
Nothing is less than a dollar.
Where are you shopping?
Online?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I've never seen things.
I was going to say, generally speaking, I would agree with you, quarter bin type thing, but I really think the quarter bin is the thing of the past now, right?
There's no quarter bins in Portland. There's some 50-cent bins, but those
dollar
are rare.
Dollar bin is the new quarter bin.
Oh, why did it jump 3 times the price?
Because it's comics.
You know what? I have found, I've been quite happy with what I found, ironically, given that I'm in Portland and could find them elsewhere anyway, but... I got some great stuff for almost nothing at, I got Silver Age stuff, not Silver Age stuff that's what most people want, but Lois Lane and
those are
Jimmy
some
Olsen.
Good looking issues. It makes me want to read Jimmy Olsen comics.
Right? They have Neil Adams covers even, and I got them for, 70% off whatever the list price was. So
was
came
that from
to,
I Like Comics?
Yeah, I Like Comics.
Yeah.
And there was another place where I got some, and then I looked at some other places that had outrageous prices. So.
Yes.
There's a mix of good prices and bad prices.
The problem I have with it is that...
But a lot of them are super overpriced.
You've got... Yes, the majority of them are just way overpriced. And then you got a few vendors that are really selling at really what they should be. Even though their sticker price is like way out of whack.
Right, but a lot... So some of the places have 50% off. And when you do the math, or 70% off in I Like Comics... When you do the math, you realize, okay, that's a good price. But if you're just looking at the stickers, it's a bit odd.
Yes.
Well, and you can't blame them for that, I guess. They got to have the deep discounts, but then they jack up to make the deep discounts look better. And that's just some of the game you play. But a quarter bin's a quarter bin. A dollar bin's a dollar bin. And when you're looking at Web of Spider-Man 84 or whatever, it's just... Nobody cares.
Another factor I think going on is that the dealers are being charged more to go to cons now.
That's true.
I've talked with my comic book shop guy, and he was upset because when Emerald City, he feels he has to do Emerald City Con. I mean, not Emerald City. Sorry, has to do Rose City, but Rose City went to 3 days, and so he has to pay a third more, even before they jacked up the prices for it.
Wait, is so.
And they apparently play other games to kind of force them to get larger booths and stuff.
So did they raise their table fees or something? Or is that, was that the implication?
You know, this was a conversation I had with him a year ago, so I can't remember all of the things he was complaining about. I know he was complaining about the 3 days. He said basically in 3 days he sold the same number of comics he sold in 2 days, but he had to pay for the 3 days.
So he's losing money.
Well, he's not losing money, but he's not making as much money as
okay,
he was.
Okay. But so that's interesting because I've heard essentially the same thing from other, listening to other podcasts and other comic book shop owners talking about their experiences at cons.
Right. So, I mean, obviously the price of the comics is going to partially have to do with the price of the rent of the space.
Yeah.
And I don't know if it was Emerald City Comic Con he was complaining about. Some Comic Con that doesn't supply the chairs and the tables.
Are you...
So that they had to get a truck to bring the tables.
I think that was San Diego.
Or maybe... I don't think he goes... Well, maybe he goes to San Diego.
Well, the conversation that I was listening to, that's what he said.
Oh, okay. I thought it was Emerald City. But
that
anyway...
Are you kidding? That is ridiculous.
Oh, it's criminal. But...
They can get away with it.
The amount of things comic conventions get away with is insane.
Wait, so does Matt, does that make you feel bad for complaining about quarter bin versus dollar bin fodder?
No. Because it's not my fault.
But you can't find any comics online for 25 cents a piece, can you?
Well, you can't.
I have not seen them that cheap online.
The gauntlet is thrown.
So a lot of comics that I buy...
This podcast is brought to you by AtomicAvenue.com. Check them out. And be careful about how you go through your vendors.
No, it's not.
I'm just saying, I just know how to shop online a little more carefully than you do.
Well, you have that better palette.
Just so listeners know, Damien and I have been on Matt's case about his delicate beer palate.
His beer snobbery. Yeah.
Just because I have taste.
Ooh. Okay.
So anyway, well, then I need to explore Atomic Avenue because...
I've never heard of this place.
In general, my shopping online, I can get comics... I think, you know, comics that I can get from 50-cent bins, I could get for $2 online or $1.50 or something. I mean, it's my general finding.
I got, but that's from comparing
shops, not the convention.
Okay, I'm going to have to look this up.
But I think if you look around, there's more comic vendors this time, and I think if you search enough, you'll find some that are good.
Yeah.
But maybe I mean, I haven't gone to that many cons. Maybe once upon a time, cons were the place to get the best bargains, and they may not be anymore.
Well, that's been my experience just going to Emerald City.
Uh-huh. So Emerald City is still the place to get the best bargains.
Yeah. I mean, for stuff, especially stuff that I was getting for, like, from the late 70s, early 80s, really cheap. There's actually one vendor in particular that I wish would come to the Portland show, but he's always complaining about not being able to support... himself, I guess. And he's always threatening that he can't come to Emerald City year after year or so.
Well, kind of like that. So cons like Rose City or Emerald City or any actual Comic-Con with some media play or whatnot isn't where you're going to get the good deals. You have to go to the vendor cons, which are the less advertised, more like it on some, you know, county show floor. That's going to be all the local stores, maybe a few national ones that make these rounds. And that's where you're going to find your deals, because they're only paying so much to be there for a few days. And they're going to really be pushing the deals. They're definitely going to have a quarter bin if they're that kind of shop and not just pushing gold and silver age keys and whatnot.
I would think, I mean, we have something like that in Portland called, it happens 4 times a year, it's called Frankenstein Comic Book Swap. It's not really swapping comics. It's people
but there's
paying
a booth.
$25 a table.
There's a booth for that here, I noticed. Yeah. Something about Frankenstein, whatever.
Yeah. They're there.
That's weird, because it's run by Cosmic Monkey. I thought it was run by Cosmic Monkey, who's a shop that has a booth there, too.
Huh.
But so that is something where anybody for $25 can get a table and put out their comics. But when I went there... it was more dollar comics than 25 cent comics. There were some 50.
Well, you're also in Portland, which is a jacked up price compared to a lot of other places around.
How much money can a guy make carrying a long box of 25 cent comics? 300 times 25, that's...
Doesn't seem quite...
Less than $100.
Yeah.
It's a lot of work. He might just decide to leave those at home and bring the ones that he can sell for more.
I think Matt is just looking...
But there are probably...
You're just cheap, man.
There are probably, some bargains.
Look, I'm cheap, and so I push it. But a quarter bin's a quarter bin, dollar bin's a dollar bin, and if you're charging me a dollar a comic that I can go read online for something I'm already paying for, I'm just not going to do it.
So how much... How much does digital comic reading play into your day-to-day comic reading?
Significantly.
Really?
It's the majority of it anymore.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
But Matt is not... Well...
Ooh. Do you want to finish that thought?
No, maybe not. It's up to Matt to finish that thought. But, I mean, when I buy digital comics on sale, they're a dollar piece. They're never less than that. So, for me...
Yeah, 99 cents.
Yeah, yeah.
I can buy 50 cents. I can buy the same comic sometimes for 50 cents if I can find it.
Unless you're on Hoopla and you're reading it for free. Oh.
Well, yes. On Hoopla, I can read them.
You
read
and your damn people with Hoopla. I don't have that opportunity in my local library.
Your local library is cheaper or has less money, maybe.
Yeah, that's very true.
Because they do have to... The library does have to pay for Hoopla.
Yeah, yeah,
it's
yeah.
not free.
Yeah.
I'm so jealous, taxpayers' though. Money.
So jealous.
Our Hoopla's gone up. It used to be you got 8 trades a month or 8 titles of whatever you got, and now it's 10. So I'm really enjoying that.
Just rubbing it in.
Yes. But anyway, I mean, I generally noticed other years that. Rose City Comic Con that there weren't really that many comic book vendors at all.
Yeah, now that you mention it, I remember
so it sounds
previous
like
years, yeah.
For comic book collecting, Emerald City's better.
Yes.
But you were also talking about the energy level. I definitely feel like I don't have the energy level from what I hear Emerald City is like, where
you have to go
ahead and wait in line to get into the panel and all that.
Yes,
stuff.
There's that, and it's
I really
4 days.
Have no patience for it.
It's oh, 4 days. Can you imagine? So... I know Matt probably doesn't feel this the way, but Damian and I could probably commiserate. I don't know. Well, you weren't here today for
right.
Saturday,
and
right?
The old part of me is, I mean, I'm sad that I missed some what sounded like good panels, especially the Ditko panel, and I wanted to see Jeff Darrow, which I missed.
Mm.
But part of me is glad I'm only doing 2 days, energy-wise. Well,
so, yeah, Rose City used to be 2 days, and they moved it
right.
to 3 days, what, yeah, last year or 2 years ago?
Last year, I think. And it feels like the first year I went, a year without you, or you might have been there and I didn't know, but I just went on a Sunday and I went and saw 4 fantastic panels in a row. And now it feels like those panels are spread out
yes.
over a greater period of time.
Yes, but I...
Sure.
As a comic book fan anyway, if I was interested in other things.
So I remarked to my wife a couple times today. This is the... old man segment of the show, but
we'll leave Matt out.
I was my legs were so tired from walking around the show floor. I could not wait to be able to sit down and just relax for an hour.
Oh wow!
I know it's horrible.
I was sitting in
someone
over three.
This is not, someone who looks like an out of shape old man. Let's say you look very fit.
Spry.
That's like the worst compliment ever.
Okay.
So, I mean, I was sitting most of the day at panel room 3, where I was taking in the Ditko panel and
right.
the Bendis Superman panel, and then an essay or a lecture about Superman and
oh,
whatnot.
I wanted to go to that so bad, because this is done by the Professor Ben Saunders, right?
Yeah.
The...
From University of Oregon?
Yes. Something. I really like him. I like what he's trying to do. Because the University of Oregon has the first and only, maybe not only, but
comic
first
book minor.
Comic book minor, right? Comic book studies minor, something like that,
you
right?
You know the best thing about him? He sounds like Ghost Critic.
Oh, really?
A little bit, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. No, now that you mention that, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. But yeah.
Let's hope Ghost Critic listens to this podcast.
So tell me about that. What was there anything special about that or anything noteworthy?
So, I mean, three of these panels were him in some form or another. And so the Superman one was the one you were keying in on. It was interesting. They're talking about Superman through the ages. So it starts off with looking at Superman where he started, where he's kind of a socialist hero pushing against consumerism and the rich and all this. And talking
wait,
about,
wait, you mean a social justice warrior?
That would be the term now, yeah.
Go on.
And so he becomes more of a conservative hero, transformed through the war, being more mainlined because of the need and the congruity at the time to, you know, fighting World War II, which they did allude to the fact that, you know, that's also some of the more questionable stuff Superman did, you know, pushing against the Japs and whatnot, that there's some of that there, and so you have to deal with that in his legacy. And then when you come out on the other side of the war, he was more conservative by nature. He was more truth, justice, and the American way, which came more from the radio show than the comics. And
the very 50s attitude.
Yeah, the Superman that Prager will point to, as opposed to the Superman that actually started, and more the conscious collective understanding of Superman's origin than what actually was Superman's origin, which is a fascinating point as well. And then kind of tracing it through the decades and how he became somewhat ridiculous and how they moved the verisimilitude of Superman to something more recognizable with Brian, a la an essay from... keep forgetting his... Batman, Neil Adams, and...
Oh, Danny O'Neill.
Danny O'Neill wrote an essay about Superman that really defined John Byrne's run and how to make Superman...
John Byrne. Sorry.
It's just a Y. Okay.
I'm like, who the hell is John Byrne?
Making Superman more relatable and how far you can push his powers before it kind of breaks your suspension of disbelief and where they thought that was. And so that there's an essay that really defined that reentry post-crisis on Superman, and then talking about Superman more in multimedia, because Superman's been more molded by non-comic multimedia than nearly any other superhero. So,
right. Especially the radio shows, right?
The radio show was big.
Doesn't the Daily Planet and Kryptonite and
Jimmy Olsen,
Crypto and Jimmy Olsen and what's the editor's name?
Perry White.
Perry White all come from the radio show, I think.
Some or all of those things.
Yeah.
But I mean, there's things that came from the black and white TV show, and there was a lot that came from the movie. In a lot of ways.
Really? I didn't realize that.
Well, the general perception of Superman was really defined by the movie.
True, but I thought the movie was based on the comics, but maybe not.
Not really, because they viewed it as kids' stuff, and so they didn't really return to the comics, and they just kind of forged ahead, and the comics just kind of followed suit, because why wouldn't they?
The movie might have, if we're talking about the Christopher Reeves movie, might have redefined the way... the way the Fortress of Solitude looked like and the way Krypton looked like. A lot.
And the way...
So a lot of visuals, maybe.
Yeah. Zod was important and...
Well, Zod was important before, wasn't he?
But he didn't look the same or act the same.
That's correct, yeah. Oh.
Okay, sorry. I shouldn't have argued that point. I don't know why. I just like to argue.
No, there's a lot brought in from a lot of different aspects in different levels in different ways, and... It's interesting to talk about it, but the question I wanted to ask him, but I didn't get to the microphone in time, was he was talking about Superman as the myth and through decades and this very high-level stuff, but he wasn't talking about the character, really, and the voice of it, and I wanted to know kind of what compared and contrasted across the decades of Superman and how that was viewed, because how did Superman kind of sound across the different decades, and how does that impact? Because he was pointing to Superman Returns, and there's this line that he was really latching onto, where one of the characters says, "It's truth, justice, and all that other stuff." Because they were afraid to talk about the American way at the height of the Bush presidency. And that hasn't even really returned through Obama.
Wait, so was that explicitly stated by him?
Yeah.
Okay.
It was. And so, and it was during Obama's presidency that you had that comic where Superman cast aside his Americanism to be more of a global hero, and that hasn't really been rescinded, but it's technically out of continuity now, and what do you make of that?
Yeah.
Well, that seems a natural part of continuity to just shift away.
Does it?
I this is a sidebar, but I'd heard someone say a number of years ago that American comic book artists are all dying to draw Batman, and that comic book artists from other parts of the world are all dying to draw Superman. That Superman is the more popular hero around the world. Batman's the more popular hero in the United States.
That's not true across all countries, I can tell you for sure. Batman is infinitely more popular in Japan.
Okay.
For sure.
Maybe the examples I was in the person talking was Latin American artists and European artists, and they didn't consider the Asian ones.
Interesting, huh?
But anyway, I mean, I think Superman as a global figure rather than an American figure is a natural extension of the core meaning of Superman, even if there was a tradition of saying American way.
Huh.
I don't think the American way thing came along till the 50s, or maybe it was during the war.
I would guess so. I don't know.
Yeah.
I haven't read those comics, but it seems like a natural progression from post-World War II America.
Right.
To what Superman then became.
Right. But I found the Ditko panel more fascinating. But you were somewhere else at the time, right?
I was. I was at the rambunctious Kirby Crackle half hour spectacle.
Has the Kirby Crackle been delivering for you?
Oh yeah. I love Kirby Crackle. Kyle is awesome.
So you've seen them now twice this weekend?
This weekend, yes. Yeah.
And you'll go again tomorrow.
I will go again tomorrow, yes.
That alone probably makes this trip worth it for you, then.
How much is he doing in 2 days?
Three shows,
yeah, for one each day.
That's a lot.
And he has a booth. You should go there.
To the booth?
To the booth. Buy some stuff.
What's he selling?
His CDs. Yeah, Crackle. Kirby Crackle. Duh! Kirby Crackle, come on!
Is that like Cracker Jack?
Wait.
When I talked to Mike Royer, he theorized that Kirby Crackle actually was created by Joe Sinnott. Say his name.
Yeah.
Sorry.
That is blasphemy, my friend.
I know.
Come on.
But this was Mike Royer, the ultimate Jack Kirby inker. Total Jack Kirby loyalist, so.
I could buy that, though. That might get some.
He thought that Sinnott started doing it, and then Kirby saw it and liked it and just went with it.
Yeah. Totally apocryphal, right?
Yeah. No, it was just Royer said it was just his theory.
Yeah.
He said he wanted to talk to Sinnott about it.
Okay, so wait. So I got to ask you guys. So have you not listened to Kirby Crackle? The band? The artist?
I listened to one song about 5 years ago, so I have not really.
I listened a little bit when I was hanging out with La Greca, but not a ton.
Huh. So it's just not something that appeals to you guys, or?
No, I would like to check him out live.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if I'm with my daughter while he's playing whether I'll get that chance.
Yeah.
Because she has a whole sound thing issues if the sounds bother her.
She probably would not have liked today because it was pretty loud. As Matt, I think, was about to allude to, or at least perhaps be explicit about.
So, when your thing was starting, I turned to someone next to me and said, it sounds like there's a roller coaster in there, because we didn't hear any music. We just heard, woo, woo. And we're about to start a scintillating discussion about the art and writing and times of a certain artist of Steve Ditko and really dig into it. And there's these hooligans a wall across from us making all this darn noise.
Celebrating, I will say, Matt, celebrating Claremont and Byrne's X-Men run, at the very least.
We can't celebrate Byrne anymore. He's a problematic figure. Unlike
I celebrate
Steve
problematic
Ditko.
Figures. I defend John Byrne and his crankiness. I don't care.
It's not his crankiness. It's the white supremacy ties that people are a little more
John Byrne
with.
Has white supremacy ties?
Supposedly.
What?
I think supposedly. These are the accusations are thrown around a little crazily. I'd have
apparently,
to hear
if you go to the blog, there's some stuff. I don't know. I heard this on the X-Men podcast.
All right. I think we should wrap this up. At least in terms of my show.
Because I have to go to the bathroom soon.
Yeah, me too.
That's always a good reason to end a podcast.
Hey! Damn youngins.
I'm willing to talk comics for as long as it takes.
Anything else about Rose City Comic Con? Because it's... What the hell time is it?
Closing in on
holy midnight. Crap, it's almost midnight. It's almost time for our...
Time to get started.
Time to get started. When you're as old as I am, I won't...
He's
I won't,
young, folks.
I won't speak for Damian. But,
There's nothing worse than people quite a bit younger than you constantly saying, I'm so old.
Yeah. Anyway, is there anything else that we want to mention about Rose City Comic Con 2018 this year?
Got a buttload of Astro City.
I'm impressed at how successful it is. It's clearly, despite our complaints about, 3 days, it's clearly getting plenty of people, enormous numbers of vendors, not selling comics, but selling something.
Yep.
The Artist's Alley area is enormous.
It is amazing.
It's like a maze to try to find.
Well, besides that, it's the level of talent there is just amazing. Right. There's so many good, for lack of a better word, unknown artists out there in Artist's Alley.
Right. And lots of well-known artists too.
Well, that's very
like
true.
Joe Harris signed all my slingers.
Really?
Yeah. That's a big thing. I mean, I know everybody loves and adores their Slingers collection.
Only if I can get them for 25 cents.
Exactly. Oh, my God.
Yeah, Matt.
That's worth $1 a piece at least.
Matt, how much did you spend on those Slingers?
Full price. I got them when they came out.
Oh, okay. This is from your own collection.
Yeah.
Okay. I actually, now that you mention it, I brought an issue of Warlock.
For Starlin?
For Starlin.
Yeah.
And every time I've gone by his table, either he's not been there, or the line is like hugely long.
I got Bendis at the right time. He just appeared at his table, and I had to wait through 3 people to get to him.
Oh my God. See, I'm hoping for tomorrow. So I'm going to bring the issue tomorrow, but I'm hoping tomorrow that I'll have some success there.
If it's like other years, Sunday's pretty slow.
That's what I'm hoping. But yeah. Considering. I think how successful Rose City has become, now that it's a 3-day show, especially, I'm kind of worried about Sunday. Because Friday, I don't know how you felt about it, but Friday was ideal because there weren't that many people.
Friday was nice.
People are the worst.
But, there was a lot of interesting cosplay, really cool cosplay that we saw today because of all the people.
Sure, yeah.
Even just dropping Matt off to get in the line, I saw lots of interesting.
I had to walk away for an hour so that I could wait 15 minutes in line later to just get into the building. It was crazy.
Wow, really? We were lucky this morning because Madison had a wooden sword to go with her Scottish dress that she was wearing. She was, Scottish warrior
All right.
person. And we got to go I mean, it wasn't like we got like the express line or anything, but it did. I think it did get us in earlier than we would have if we would have been just, you know.
Was there a separate line for cosplayers?
Well, there's a separate line for any kind of weapon.
Oh, so they needed to check it.
Yeah.
But it actually got you in faster.
It got, yes, it did. It did.
Wow.
So that's your tip, your Rose City Comic Con tip for the day.
I can see it getting to the point where I just go one day.
Yeah?
Just because I, you know, the crowds may be too much.
I think they need to sell a Saturday-Sunday pass.
That would make sense.
That would be ideal for me.
Yeah. So do they only say sell one day or 3 days?
It's either each day or all 3 days.
Right.
I think they should sell a crotchety old man pass where you're allowed in each day, but only like 3 hours a day.
And they provide a wheelchair.
And someone to push it.
Right. In a good costume.
Okay. I think we're done. All right, that's it. We're done, right?
Cheers.
Yes.
Cheers. Prost.
Prost. Sláinte.
So we are recording now on Sunday evening. The con is over with. Instead of doing it the morning after, because we have to get up early to go drive back home, I decided to do it tonight. Madison gave a big thumbs down because we have to go home, and I agree.
Well, I want to go home for gymnastics anyway.
Well, that's true. You have gymnastics that evening, so we gotta be home. I got to be home because I want to watch the finale of So You Think You Can Dance.
Wait, I'm missing that?
Apparently you are. Sucks to be you. But let's talk about the final sadness day. Sadness that we're no longer at the con. Rose City Comic Con 2018. So we got up late. We usually... When we go to these cons, we're right there when the doors open. So we maximize our day, get our money's worth, do all this stuff, right? But we were all very tired after Saturday. Me especially, because I went out and had some fun with Damian and Matt afterwards, after dinner.
And
Saturday
was out
night.
Very late.
I was out pretty late. But I, you know what? I was the first one up.
Surprisingly.
Anyway.
No, I was the first one up.
No, up, sure. You were out of bed, but you were not awake and up and about like I was. But we're not here to argue about that.
Well, I was crawling around like a monster.
Yeah, you were being weird this morning. Anyway, we got to the con late, but you know, it being Sunday and the fact that we were so late, we just breezed right on through the queue to get inside, which was good. And then we made it over to see again for the third time this weekend, Kirby Crackle, Kyle perform. And it was a nice set because he did a bunch of different songs.
This time we actually stayed for the whole thing.
And no, we stayed for the whole thing for all. I did. I stayed for all three of them for the
whole
time.
This time I did.
Yeah. And while we were there, Damian and his daughter showed up for a little while. We hung out with them for a bit, and then Damian's daughter had to go home. And then what did we do?
Then we went to look at Legos, and then she left.
Right.
And then we went to a art panel.
Oh, the image. Hold on, let me look up the exact title. The Image Comics Live Draw with Ryan Otley, Megan Hutchison, and Andrew McLean.
They were some interesting drawings.
Yeah, so they like the DC art one, similar to DC art one, they were drawing as they were talking. There was a moderator talking to each of the artists who wasn't drawing.
But this time they were drawing on an iPad.
They were drawing. They were doing digital drawing. They were doing a digital drawing. And Ryan Otley went first, and he was drawing a character called Invincible. I don't know if you knew that.
Nope.
And then the other guy, Andrew, drew a – what would you say that was? Like a
like
werewolf
monster
type thing? Yeah. almost like it was attacking Invincible. And then Megan drew something, but I had already, Gabby and I left to go to the spotlight on Jerry Conway panel that was halfway through the Image Comics Live panel. So I missed what Megan drew. So what did she draw, Madison?
So on the werewolf monster thing, she drew a mermaid, like riding on the werewolf.
Riding on it?
Like holding on, and just like her tail was over the arm, and she was just like, "Wee!"
That's funny. I wish I could have seen that. Mm-hmm. But then once she had done that, was that pretty much the panel?
Yeah.
Yeah, and then what'd you go do after that?
After that, we kind of just walked around, ate pizza.
Well, that comes a little bit later.
Yeah. We went and looked at some Supernatural shirts.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So while you guys were doing that, walking around and stuff and eating pizza, Gabby and I went to that Jerry Conway spotlight, which I really enjoyed that. That was a lot of fun. I'm going to talk about that a little bit more in my solo summary of the Rosita Comic Con. What did you think of that conversation, Gabby? Were you just bored out of your mind, or did you find any of it interesting?
I found it all interesting because they were mainly talking about Spider-Man, and mm-hmm. I really like Spider-Man in general.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I thought it was about the Legends of Tomorrow.
No. I don't know why you thought that.
Oh. Because that's what I thought the name was.
No.
So I liked it. I actually loved it.
Yeah.
But I missed some of it. That was disappointing, but I liked it.
Yeah.
Why'd you miss
it? You didn't miss anything.
When I went to the bathroom.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, okay. So then after that was done, so Grandma had told me that she was getting pizza, and I was really hungry.
Pizza.
So Gabby and I left that panel, went and found you guys, and then we had some pizza. It was the most delicious thing on the entire planet at that moment to me. So I was very appreciative that Kitra had gotten that. And then what did we do? Because that was the Jerry Conway panel was my last panel. Gabby and I did. Oh yeah, You and Kitra went to what?
We went
the puppet thing
to a puppet museum show.
Right. So apparently there's a puppet museum in Portland, and they were putting on a show
on the play fair show.
Yeah, stage.
Like, stage.
Yeah,
sorry.
Where Kyle was.
Yes, and then they were doing songs and some kids like. Volunteers, which were the kids.
Did you volunteer?
No.
Oh.
Got to come up.
Did you want to volunteer and you just didn't get to, or you just didn't want to at all?
I just didn't want to. I wanted to watch.
Just want to sit and watch. Yes. Okay. So while you were doing that, while you were doing that, Gabby and I went and I did some more shopping, comic shopping, and found a few more All-Star Squadron issues. Yay. And we met up with Matt and Damian.
Why'd you guys meet up with them?
They were looking at comics too. And so we hung out for a little bit, and then they had to leave because it was time for Matt to go back to Colorado.
So far.
Yeah. And I think that was about it. Then we got back together with you guys, you and Kitra, and basically called it a day, didn't we? We actually left about
But before we met up, me and Grandma went and said thank you for comics I got from and children's books I got from Sebastian. And then he gave me some more free comics.
Yeah, so that makes him having been mentioned now all the times that we've talked about our time at the con. So he made quite an impression on you.
Yes, he did.
Okay. And then we, right before we left, we decided to go say goodbye to Kyle. Once again, he gave us all high fives, which I thought was pretty cool.
Yeah. And, oh yeah, I just remembered I got a picture with Bat Duck.
Oh yeah, there was, so the University of Oregon Duck was roaming around the con during the weekend dressed up as Bat Duck. And you saw it and wanted to get a picture with him. So we did that.
Yeah.
Okay. Anything else?
Yeah. When Grandpa was shopping for comics, I saw a really cool Riddler costume and quite a few Doctor Strangers.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, what other cool cosplay did you see today, Madison?
Well, today I saw, I can't remember her name. I keep blanking out on her name. It was something Rabbit.
Jessica Rabbit.
Jessica Rabbit, when we were in line walking up, she had like fake hair on.
She looked a lot like the cartoon version. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the dress was very sparkly.
Very sparkly, yeah. I thought that was pretty good.
Yeah. And then yesterday, I think, since I forgot about this, but yesterday it was Friday. I saw this person dressed up as Castiel from Supernatural.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. AKA Cass.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I saw a couple today, too.
Yeah.
I only saw
I can't think of any notable cosplay.
I mean, I
now myself.
I from kept today. Seeing Harry Potter and Wonder Woman's.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. And when we were at the puppet thing, me and Grandma, we saw this little girl dressed up as a Harley Quinn.
Mm-hmm.
It was really cute. And her hair had, like, I think hair dye in it, too.
Yeah.
It was nice.
Okay.
And I also saw one of Grandpa's favorite sidekicks, Nightwing costumes and Robin and a lot of Batmans.
Nightwing is not a sidekick.
But he was.
Nightwing was Robin. He turned into Nightwing.
I think
he turned into Batman.
Yeah, I think most of my listeners know this already.
Maybe. Maybe not.
Okay. I think that's it. So, what do you think? Another Comic-Con done. It was pretty cool. How does this one rate, say, compared to last year's? Better? About the same?
Actually, a lot better because... there's a lot of different things than last year's, and I really like seeing different things than see the same thing each.
That's true. Year. They did make some changes to the con, which is good. I mean, they
didn't have arcade this year.
Yeah, that's the thing I was going to mention specifically. So they didn't have the retro arcade that they had last year, which bummed Madison out. But I don't care. I don't care that they didn't have it from my own standpoint. So I'm sorry that you were disappointed though.
Grandma would have liked
that. That's true. Yeah, she would have liked that too. Okay. But you know, you gotta change things up to make the con interesting, especially for people like us who seem to go every year.
But people like us like arcade games.
Yeah. All right. Well,
they have this.
Are we going to go again?
Yeah.
This time we need to go to Emerald City Comic Con, though. Well,
but this is about Rose City Comic Con.
Fine. No, but if we're gonna
open that door, there's a bunch of other cons I would like to go to.
I would like to go to the one you went to by yourself.
Heroes Con?
Yes.
Oh my gosh, I would love for you guys to go to that one. That's so much fun.
As long as I can dress up for that one.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I think that's it. Another con behind us, and we will do this again some other time. All right, girls, say bye bye.
Peace out.
Peace.
Well, I hope you enjoyed all that discussion from the various people that I talked with about Rose City Comic Con. As for my final thoughts about the Rose City Comic Con, I always enjoy going to cons, and Rose City has become our new favorite con from the two somewhat local. I'm talking about Seattle, Portland area. As we discussed this. It's all become a blur in my discussion with Matt and Damian, or this might have been something that we just kind of talked about outside of the recording. I don't remember, guys. I'm sorry. But Emerald City has just gotten too big for us, although, you know, we do want to go back eventually. And Rose City, for me, I think I talked about this, but 3 days is almost too much just because I'm old and I get tired easily these days. So... boy, if they ever go to 4 days, I don't know that I'll attend a 4-day con anymore. I think 2 full days is probably good enough. However, kind of depends on what I want to accomplish. And this year for Rose City Comic Con, I was in a shopping mood again, and I wanted to find some stuff. A few days before we went, I went through my comics and was trying to pick out some things that I wanted to get more of. And the two titles that I kind of landed on was the post-crisis George Perez Wonder Woman run. I had the first, 13, 14 issues of that when it was coming out back in, 1985-ish, 86. And for some reason, I dropped it. I don't know why. I can't remember why I did it. It was kind of foolish. But I decided I wanted some more of George Perez's Wonder Woman. So I ended up getting, easily so, for the most part, up to issue 24. So that's what I wanted to get. I don't know that I want to get more than that. I'll have to go read through those and see if I want more. But the other one I really wanted was All-Star Squadron. And I have been looking, I've been eyeing getting All-Star Squadron for years. I have one of those Showcase Presents black and white collections, but I've been really kind of nostalgic for late 70s and 80s through the mid 80s comics, and All-Star Squadron was one of those. And so I pulled the trigger and decided I wanted to get those. Ended up getting 16, 17, 18 issues, something like that. A good chunk of them. I got about a third of what I need to get. I already had about, 3 or 4 issues already, including issue number one. But I got a good chunk of that. I'm looking forward to finding more. I know I can find those at other comic shops as well. So I'll be on the lookout for those now and spending some money there. In addition to those two titles, I have a wish list, of course, just like any comic collector does. And on the wish list was an issue. I have a couple issues of Daredevil for the run that I want. And I finally got one of those, which I think is a Steve Ditko cover. I'm not sure of that, but it's issue 162. And I found it really cheap. I think it was only a couple bucks. And which is nice, because I've only been able to find this thing much more expensive than that. In fact, the sticker price of this thing was $6, which is still cheaper than what I've seen it online. So I consider that a huge win. And this is not the next one I want to talk about is not one that I was even looking for, but in looking for All-Star Squadron at the I Like Comics vendor there, they had this first issue special, Dr. Fate, which is it was reprinted in one of the DC Digests. It's one of the first DC Digests that I got, featuring the JSA. And in that digest was this Dr. Fate story drawn by Walt Simonson. And I love that story. I really like this Dr. Fate story. And this was a cover, sticker price at $8. It's a 25-cent comic. But I got it for $1. So huge win for me right there. And then I also I saw that Xander Cannon was at Rose City Comic Con, and I kept walking by his table. He was never there for the times that I was out wandering the show floor. But he had his Kaiju Max first trade for $10, his season one. And Sleepy Reader 666, Damian, has recommended that series to me, and I thought, well, for $10, I should get this. So I kept walking by his table throughout the weekend, hoping to catch him. And then finally Sunday he was there, and I told him that I came to buy this based on the recommendation of Damian. Damian happened to be with me, so I was able to thank Damian that way in front of the creator of the book. And it was very nice. He drew a little sketch on the inside of the trade. So I thought that was a pretty good deal for $10. And then finally, Damian, as a present, very nicely, gave me a couple issues of Adventure Comics featuring Superboy and the Legion of Superheroes. This is issues 336 and 337. So 336 is the shocking, unguessable, the true identity of Starfinger. And 337 is, you'll be stunned when you see the fantastic powers of the new members who replace the Legionnaire dropouts. And superpowers of new Legionnaires suggested by our readers, it says. And it shows, on the cover, it shows Lightning Lad and Saturn Girl and Ultra Boy and Phantom Girl getting married, apparently. So I can't wait to take a look at those. So thank you, Damian, for that. I really appreciate that. I did not get any prints or art. There's a few things I looked at, including an artist who had this really cool pencil sketch of Hawk Woman. Almost got it, but I thought that the price he was trying to sell it at, that was just a little too much for the sketch that it was. But, one of these years, I seem to have caught the bug that my buddy Travis has. He's passed that along to me. Thanks a lot, Travis. Where I don't really want to buy any prints or anything. I want to get sketches. I want to get some commissions done of various characters, mostly Robin. I think I've talked about this before, but I want to. One of these days, I'm going to take a sketchbook and I'm going to, as much as I can, spend as much money as I can and ask all these different artists to draw me pictures of Robin, whatever they want to do. So that's been my thing. One of these days, I'll actually pull the trigger and do it. But, I had a really great time hanging out with my family, with Damian and Matt at the con, and also Saturday night, as you heard. And believe me, there's a lot more conversation than that, but I cut it back a little bit. I really had a great time attending the each day Kirby Crackle did a little mini concert, and I had a great time listening to Kyle. We also stopped by his booth and talked with him. He's a great guy. If you haven't listened to Kirby Crackle, you really should. The highlight as far as media guests was Felicia Day. As I told my wife, as we were sitting in the panel with Felicia Day, she'd been talking for a little bit, and I just finally turned to her and whispered in her ear, "I'm in love with her, just so you know." But she's just a great entertainer. I listened to her audiobook earlier this year or last year. I don't remember when it came out, but it was great. It was a great book. And I found out there that she has a podcast called, I think, Felicitations. And I've been listening to that. So it's great to, absorb, what she has to offer. So I that was one of the highlights coming out of Rose City Comic Con, was that. And the girls and I talked about the DC Art Academy panel, and that, as I said, I think I said this before earlier in the broadcast with them, it really, really has me jonesing to draw again and maybe even write again and just create something. And I know I constantly talk about this, and I keep thinking, if I keep talking about it, announcing it here with you guys, that maybe I'll actually follow through one of these days. So we shall see. I do have some regrets, though, about Rose City Comic Con. I always have regrets coming away from a con, because I don't have enough money, don't have enough time, schedules don't mesh up. So this year's Rose City Comic Con was no different. I did take an issue of Strange Tales featuring Warlock. This is issue 178 that I intended to have Jim Starlin sign, and it just didn't work out. The one time I was there where Jim Starlin was at his table, the line was just huge. And so I didn't want to spend, even half an hour standing in line. I don't know how long it would have been, but I just didn't, there's so much to do and so much to see. I didn't want to do that. So, I'll regret that, but I did go to his panel, so that, I kind of made up for it, or at least half his panel. I missed David Tennant. My wife went to that and said it was just a hoot. It was so much fun for her. And I really like David Tennant, but I was busy buying comics. So I did find on YouTube, I did find someone who recorded the panel. A good chunk of it, though, is just they're recording the audio and it's just it's black. They put down their video recorder. And, you know, it's hard to hear too because it's not, you know, you're listening to everything around that recorder. So, but anyway, it's there. What am I complaining about? It's, I'm able to listen to it at least. So I need to go back and finish that. I also really wanted to see the Deconstructing Superman panel with Professor Ben Saunders. Matt talked about that, but I really wanted to see that. And I'm kicking myself for not attending that one. And I regret not finding as many comics as I wanted to find. There were a few vendors that I just simply, like there was one, the last day I found some of the All-Star Squadron comics. These were 50-cent comics, guys. I know Matt was complaining bitterly about the lack of 50-cent bins or whatever. Maybe I was. I don't remember now. It's all become a blur. But there was someone there selling 50-cent comics. A lot of them were just not in great shape. And I turned up my comic book nose, my delicate comic book nose up at that the first 2 days. And like the third day, I'm like, well, I haven't checked them out. I might as well. And I found some good comics some All-Star Squadron comics in pretty good condition for 50 cents. So now I'm kicking myself that I did not go to that vendor the first 2 days. So I need to get over that where it's just like, you know, if the comics are, you know, presentable enough, and that means different things to different people and sometimes means different things to me depending on the day. But as long as they're presentable, they're in some sort of order. There were a few of the vendors there where they just had comics all, you know, all mixed up, not in any kind of order. That just bugs the crap out of me. I hate thumbing through. I did though one because the guy said, yeah, I remember seeing some All-Star Squadron in the DC boxes that were not in order. I never found any. I need to just let that go and go look and find the stuff, spend the time and find the stuff. So I'll regret that. I'll keep looking. That's part of the fun too, is the search, the find. And then finally a regret, Damian, along with the Adventure Comics, also gave me when we were at McMenamin's, he gave me a trade collection of the title. I think it was called Sacred Creatures, which is a book that I was actually interested in and forgot to buy it in trade when it came out. But he gave that to me, and then I left it in the back of his car when he drove me back to the hotel. And we never were able to hook up again where he had the book. So I'll regret that. Damian, I'm sorry. If you're listening to this and send it to me, I'll reimburse you. or you could just keep it, and next time I go to Portland and visit with you, maybe you can give that to me. And if you want to, if you want to give it to somebody else, please do. But I will regret that because I think we had plans to talk about that at some point. So yeah, those are my regrets. I have a few. I forgot one of the things I really liked was the Jerry Conway panel that I went to. I think that was on the last day. Mostly for this. It was really great to hear him talking about the various things that he, the iconic things that he was involved in, including Amazing Spider-Man 121, which was the death of Gwen Stacy. And so that's why I really wanted to talk about that with you, was that, so here's my observation. It was, and this only occurred to me later, after we got back home. I realized that, so this year, 2018, is my 40th year of comic book reading and collecting. So it was in the late fall, early winter of 1978, where I bought three comics that changed my life. One of them was Avengers 177, the final issue of the Korvac saga. Another issue was Amazing Spider-Man 187, which featured Captain America and Electro. And I've talked about these before in previous episodes of the podcast, including episode 100. I don't remember the other one. and then a reprint of Amazing Spider-Man 121. This was in Marvel Tales number 98. And that was a reprint, like I say, of 121, The Death of Gwen Stacy. And so here I am sitting in a panel in September of 2018 with Jerry Conway, the writer of one of those comics that launched me into this 40-year journey of reading and loving and talking and writing about comic books. And it was just one of those serendipitous moments. I wish I'd kind of realized that when I was sitting there, but I mean, I actually had planned to kind of tell an abridged version of this story to Jerry Conway if they were going to take questions. But they never did because Professor Ben Saunders had packed his panel with a lot of observations and questions for Mr. Conway, and that was fine. So I didn't get to do that directly to Mr. Conway, but I just thought it was a really cool convergence of time and interest regarding these comics that I love so much. So it was really cool. It's still really cool to me to think about that. But anyway, and I think that's it. That's pretty much all I want to talk about. Eventually, the girls and I will do our video. At the time of this recording, we were going to do that today, which is a week later. This is after the con ended. So this is Sunday after the con, the Sunday after the con. It's not going to work out. So I'll have to wait to get the two girls together and shoot the video and then post that to YouTube. But it'll be at longboxreview.com or on the Longbox Review YouTube channel. Either way, you can go to longboxreview.com to find this posted. If you were at Rose City Comic Con, and I did see some people that I follow on Twitter who were at Rose City Comic Con, but I didn't realize it until afterwards. But if you were there and you listened to the show, I would love to hear your thoughts about the Rose City Comic Con, as well as your thoughts about the various things that we've talked about regarding Rose City Comic Con. And you can do that by emailing me at longboxreview@gmail.com. You can also message me on Twitter or tweet at me on Twitter, or I don't know what the appropriate verb here is, but you can interact with me at Longbox Review. And if you'd like, go to iTunes, Apple Podcasts, and rate and review the show. I'd really appreciate that. Thanks for listening, and I will talk to you later. Bye-bye.